Hey everybody, it's Killer Minis!
You know, I really liked that, but I didn't like this.
Straight up.
So now Silas, you're going to select Silas to go first because you want to open this door up here. And we want to see what's in there. So Silas is going to spend an action to move forward. And then he's going to use this greatsword that it only takes it takes a 5 or a 6 to open that door. Not very accurate. So he has an option to shoot his bow over at the fatty.
Keep in mind that the bow is only a one-strength weapon.
So the fatty's going to laugh at as many bows as he throws into him successfully. It's not going to damage him. So he's going to take a mighty swing at the door, and he rolls a 4 and does not open the door. So he'll spend another action, try to check his luck, another 4. So he swung twice with this large, very inaccurate weapon and failed to bash down that door successfully. Alrighty, so that's Silas's turn done. So your next player and your only remaining player is Baldrick. And Baldrick really can't contribute too much because he can't take out this zombie. So I'd say just stay where he's at. He's going to perform a search. And he finds a walker. So that's something that can happen. The odds are fairly low, but every once in a while you'll encounter a zombie while you're searching. So it's not always free loot, right? So we go ahead and place a walker miniature and put it right in there. Now luckily, he's got 2 more remaining combat spells. However, something that we didn't cover yet so far, which is a ranged attack. When you perform a ranged attack, if you are firing into a zone that contains other survivors excluding yourself, and that would include Anne, if I were to roll, say with the fireball, 3 dice, and I miss with 2 of my dice, those would be hits that are assigned to Anne, and she would be subject to friendly fire. And unless she has armor to try to save against it, which she doesn't in this case, I could basically almost kill her with one accident, right? So because of that, I'm not going to take the chance and harm Anne. So I'm not going to attack with what I have. And I just don't have a weapon that... now this only happens with ranged weaponry. You know, your bows, your crossbows, magic spells. Melee weapons, you can't friendly fire with a melee weapon, right? Makes sense. So we're going to do the next best thing, and we're going to try to get away. And this is going to give me an opportunity to show you that... He spent 1 action searching, so he's got 2 remaining, right? Now, when you move and you try to move away from or out of the zone that was occupying an enemy figure, it's going to cost you more than just the 1 movement point to be able to get out. And what that means is, since there's only 1 walker, it's going to cost the normal 1 action to move, but then 1 more because it's kind of hard to slip away while he's in there engaging us. So it will take 2 actions for him to move out. If there were 2 zombies, it would actually take me 3 actions to move out. And it just keeps going up, and the more that are in there, the more unlikely it is that you even have enough actions to escape. So you got to be careful when you charge into melee that you don't get stuck in there, right? Because remember, as soon as a zombie phase comes, they're going to attack us, right? And we don't want to be standing there when they attack us, obviously. So he's going to move away and spend the rest of his actions, and your turn would be done. So now we'll head off into my turn. And we'll go ahead and start with Anne, since she's in here with a walker. She already has 1 experience point in the game. It's going to be a swing or hammer. She rolls a 1, so she misses. And I'm going to pick another lucky die. And she's going to use her 2nd action. And it was so lucky that I missed with a 2. Back to the red for the 3rd action. She gets a 6, and she takes the walker down. So, and then I'll give her another experience point. We'll bump her up. And so now she's at 2 total. But her turn is done. She's performed 3 actions. So now I'll switch you over to Nelly. And that's unfortunate that Anne had to get tied down because she was the only one that has enough strength, a powerful enough weapon to take down this fatty. So now Nelly is in a bit of a pickle. Nelly's going to get out of dodge, knowing that she can't do anything now. So she's going to run down 1. And remember, she has a free move action. I say run, but she's moving 1.
And so she still has three remaining actions. So then she'll move in for one action. Her second action will be to search. And she finds a speed scroll. Now, anybody can use this, not just a magic user. And it gives you the instructions of what it does. But basically, what this does is anybody that she can see, she can cast this spell. And then that particular model can go ahead and take a move action out of our normal turn sequence. So Nelly's going to go ahead and put that into her right hand, okay? Because remember, it has to be there in order to use it. So that was her second action was to her second action was to search. Now, see, that won't really do any good either. Let's get back to this. They can move up to two zones. So Nelly has actually one more action left. She's going to go ahead and cast that spell, the speed spell, on Anne. Now, this is an exception what I told you earlier where they move out of sequence. That's going to allow Anne, because of that special enchantment, it's going to allow her to move up to two spaces. So she's going to move here for one and here for two. Reason why I did that is she's the only one with the hammer, which is strong enough to take out the fatty, right? So, anyhow, that was Nelly's turn done, right? So she moved in, she searched, and technically she's got one more action left. So before I finish her turn, I think what... hold on. Free, move, search, cast. So she is done. I was thinking I could move her out here, but I can't. That's okay. So my turn's done, and that basically means that our survivor team turn is completely done. And we head off into the zombie phase. So remember what I said, the first thing is attacks. So there's no zombies that have a survivor in their own zone, so there'll be no attacks to happen. We'll use this as an example, had Baldrick been here in the zone next to the fatty, he would automatically hit Baldrick. He doesn't have to roll. There's no rolling. It's just auto hit. And then Baldrick would take one wound of damage. And what I didn't explain to you when I was showing you the character cards is this zone right here, these pegs, it goes up to the number 3. So basically you can take 3 hits before you're dead. So once you take one hit, you move your peg over, and then another hit, peg over, another hit, your peg over. So that's how that works. So as you can see, it's pretty dangerous to end your turn standing in the same zone as a zombie. But sometimes it does happen. And there's also, you do have the ability to use armor once we find it in the equipment deck to try to mitigate some of those wounds. Now I'm going to put Baldrick back because he wasn't really there. So we're in the zombie phase. There's no attacks to happen. So we skip the first step. The second step is movement. So what we do, these two can't move because they're locked in a room and they've got nowhere to go but the own zone that they're in. But this one here can go ahead and move forward. Now there's some rules for moving the zombies. And basically what it comes down to is the zombies are going to move towards the largest group or the noisiest group, basically the noisiest group that they can see. In the event that they can't see anybody, they're still going to move to the largest, noisiest group through the shortest path possible. Now these guys, since they're in one room, they're just banging up against the walls looking to try to get to this noise. So he's looking to come out this way and he's looking to come out that way, but the door is blocking their way. So they're just like, you know, they're zombies, they're stupid, they're banging their head against the door, they're trying to come at us, but that's as far as they go. But this walker does move up, and he doesn't attack, because remember, the zombies, either they move or they attack. And because the attacks happen first, you would know that he's not going to attack us unless we keep him standing there for the following turn. So anyhow, the third phase of the zombie phase is the spawn phase. Remember, we only have one active spawn, so we will now flip the card, and we find one walker. So one walker comes shambling from the darkness into this spawn point. And so we're still looking pretty good. We'll change the turn marker over here. And we'll, so let's go ahead and start off with my turn first. And we'll start with Anne. Now, let's take a zoom in again. Remember, Anne is the only one with this strength of two, wounding two weapon, which is this Hammer of Doom, I guess. So it only rolls one dice, hitting on 4+.
So she's looking for a 4, 5, or 6.
With his first action, which is a combat action. Look at that. She rolls a 6. So right away, she dispatches the fatty. She gains one more experience point, and that threat is now gone. So her one action is complete. Now, in addition, now she's going to take a swing at this door, okay, with her second action. She has to get a 4, 5, or 6. Not so lucky this time. So she wasted an action trying to... This door is really sealed shut. First it was locked with a magical power, and now we just can't seem to penetrate the brick to even get our little faces in there. You can see it's like a crypt, so it's kind of thematic anyhow. So Anne's third action, she rolls, and still no success, does not open the door, and her turn is complete. So now Nelly. Nelly's going to go ahead and use her free move action to move here. Then she's going to move her first action to go here, and that's going to give her two remaining actions to try to get this freaking door open. So she rolls. She gets a 4. And remember, with a short sword, it's a 4, 5, or 6 on an open, right? So, boom, door is open. She has one remaining action. But before I show you what she does with the action, we have to spawn this building zone. So we flip a card. There's only one room equals one card. Oh, we get a double spawn. This is something new to the game. And it basically means whenever this happens, you skip that spawn, don't put anything down. Then you go to the next point and you draw two cards on that point. And of those two cards, you might get another double spawn, so it can keep cycling in a never-ending loop, theoretically. And sometimes it almost does, never-ending. It gets pretty ugly quick. But since we only have one active spawn point, we just go right back to that same spawn point and we draw two cards. And we get in the blue zone one walker for this card and one walker for that. So we take two of our walker figures and pop it right there. And, oops, not there. I wonder why I was having a brain fart. Right in the building zone. Right? Because that's what we were doing. We were spawning for the building zone. So as she breaks down the door, this is what we find in the crypt. Two walkers. I love the artwork on this too, by the way. If you can't tell, just from an overhead view, the way that they lay out the different... There's always really neat little details like blood, and here you can see a crypt, and there's a chair, and this looks like a chest, and it's if you really pay attention to it, it can be another thing that you can enjoy about the game is just the good artwork. So anyhow, Nelly still has one action remaining, so I think what's going to happen is she's going to go ahead. She's going to go ahead with her next action. It's not going to really do her any good to charge in, right? So what she's going to do is give somebody kind of a buff. She has this speed enchantment that you can only perform once during the player turn, right? Whoever casts it. So she's going to cast speed on Anne, or no. She's going to cast speed on Silas. And so he gets to move up the two zones, and it only takes one to get in here. And he's moving out of turn, okay? So that's basically Nelly's... Was that Nelly or Anne? Now I am confused. No, Anne couldn't open the freaking door. Nelly, yeah, Nelly's done. So my turn is done. Even though Silas jumped ahead, it was one of those out of turn things that, you know, the special rules allow. So now it's your turn, and you're going to go ahead and start with Baldrick. Baldrick's going to move up one. Remember what I said is that you can see pretty much as far as you can see in one or two directions before you run into basically a wall, right? So if Baldrick looks to the right here, there's a building here, no opening in the artwork, so he can't see down here. There's just this huge wall in his way. He can see forward basically till this wall here. So he sees through the open door. If this door was closed, obviously he couldn't see. And he can see all the way down here. But so because he can see in, and there's a special rule, you can only ever see one zone deep into a building, just so you know. This is still only one zone deep. So he can see Silas and these two zombies in this room. So it doesn't matter if, like, you know, is he can't actually see this one over here if you draw a straight line. It's all abstract. Okay? As long as you can see into the building, the abstract thinking is to think that they're all moving around. And there might even be other holes that you could see through, that kind of thing. So anyhow, Baldrick moves one forward, and then he's going to go ahead and cast his Mana Blast spell to try to help Silas out and hit one of these zombies. Now remember, this is a ranged weapon. He's shooting from one away. His Mana Blast is good at zero or one range distance of range. If he misses this roll, he's going to friendly fire his own guy. So hopefully this doesn't happen. And he didn't miss. He actually got a hit. He needed a 4, 5, or 6. So he can take that hit and then apply it to the zombie. Had it been a miss, he would have had to apply that hit, that miss, to it would have counted as a wound to his survivor friend, right? So I did that on purpose to show you how that works. So there is there's some danger at firing into a zone where your friends are at, big time. So in this case, he got lucky, and that brings him up to 6 experience points. So he basically moved and attacked. He has one more action, and then he does have a free magic action. So what he's going to do is go ahead and fire with his third action at this walker over here. And he hits. So he takes out this zombie. Now, let's see
how this works now. So that next one that he got brings him up to 7. So now that that happens, you take your little peg here and you put it in the yellow slot, and that denotes that he now has one extra action.
So that's pretty cool. So now you get to use it immediately. So he just completed his third action. And so now he's got a free action. So technically, he could even go ahead and move into here for his last action. And remember, I still haven't used his blue skill spellcaster ability, which is one free magic action. So he's going crazy. He's got bloodlust for zombies right now. He's going to go ahead and try this. If he misses, he's going to hurt Silas. But he's going to do it anyway because he's a foolhardy magician. And he does. He misses. So instead of wounding him, he needed a 4, 5, or 6. He's going to place a wound on Silas. So what we do
is we come on over to Silas and place the wound tracker over on the one marker. So you can zoom in so you can see that little 1, 2, and 3.
So he's got 2 more hits before he's dead, which isn't good. In reality, he's got 1 more, and then he's really in trouble, right? Because as soon as you hit the third, he's out of the game. So Silas says, ouch, right? So anyhow, that was Baldrick's last remaining action, his free action. And Silas is going to go ahead and try to get rid of this last walker. So Silas is going to take his... let's see what he's got now.
Remember Silas has the short bow, which you only roll 1 dice per action. It's more accurate. It hits on a 3, 4, 5, or 6. But the greatsword, you roll 5 dice, but you've got to get a 5 or 6.
So first we're going to go ahead and try that, because you can't friendly fire using a melee weapon. So we're going to go ahead and roll 5 dice and hope that we get a 5 or 6 to take out this last walker. And there you go. We get 1 5. So that big powerful weapon, it can hit big if you roll well. So boom, he takes the one out, and I'll give him 1 experience point. And that's his only one left. It's his only experience point of the game. And yeah, that was Silas's first action. He's got 2 remaining. So
he's going to go ahead and swing at this door here. So we can progress into the map. He rolls a 5. That's exactly what he needed. A 5 or a 6 on the greatsword to open the door. And this door opens. As soon as that door opens, we have 1 room. And then there's a room back here. So we're going to draw 2 spawns. We would draw for these over here, but there's a locked door. So that means that the Fog of War still remains active in there. Okay? So we'll draw a spawn for this room. And we're in the blue phase. We have 1 walker. And then we'll draw for this room, and we get 2 walkers. So one walker joins the fatty, and then we get 2 in this last room back here. And, that's what we find when we bash that door down. So put these in the discard pile.
And that's basically the end of the player turn.
Remember, the first thing is to attack. There's no valid attacks, so we'll skip that step. The next step is movement. Remember, like I said, they move toward the largest group, the loudest group of survivors. Now, what I haven't told you about is the noise mechanic. And basically, we've been bashing on this door, and every time we do that, we create a noise token, which at the end of the zombie phase, we clear them until the following survivor turn that we create more noise. So the concept behind this is that there's certain weapons in the game that are going to be noisy. So most of your melee weapons, they're quiet. But your ranged weapons, some of them are loud and some of them are quiet. Magic spells, however, from what I can see, are pretty much always noisy because of the large, you know, forces of nature that are at work. They're noisy. In addition, a survivor can also just spend an action and create noise and say, okay, that's one action, another action of noise. And the purpose behind doing this is to create a lot of noise to run a diversion for other survivors. So that way it appears that you're larger than what you really are and all the zombies come to you. Meanwhile, your one survivor that's off at a corner all by his lonesome can squeak, you know, across the alleyway and get through. That's the concept there. In addition, as far as noise, every survivor naturally generates one noise token every turn, no matter what they do, just because moving around is noisy. So anyhow, in this case, the noise would actually be, because we were bashing on that door like multiple times, the noise would actually be right here. There'd be like five or six noise tokens. Three for the bashing the door and two for the survivors. So these zombies are all going to try to move toward that noise, right? But what's going to happen is they're going to hit here first. So this one moves up one and this one moves up one. We don't have to worry about them attacking us till next turn. This one's still locked behind the door. And these two will move forward one because they hear the noise. And the next turn they'll come through the door. You kind of see how that works. It's really, it's an automatic artificial intelligence mechanic, right? Little difficult to really see it work in its glory on a small map like this. So I'd recommend looking at some of my future missions and uploads I'll be doing, where we're going to cover all the missions in the Zombicide book, all 10 of them. And you'll get real familiar, if you watch those, with how the zombies move from an artificial intelligence standpoint en masse on a larger map. So anyhow, all the zombies are done moving, and now we do spawn. So we spawn at the only eligible spawn point, which is here, and we get one runner. So we'll go ahead and grab a runner, and we'll put it down here. Now, we haven't come across a runner yet, I mean, other than it being on the board over here, but basically when they move two squares. But they are dangerous, because if they move one square, they still have one more remaining, which means that they could attack us. So they're very fast, and they're very deadly. Especially if they start in your zone, then they can actually attack you twice. So the runners are very scary. You want to have a plan when you come across them. The fatties, they're slow. They're hard to kill because you need special weapons. But they certainly don't hit you twice a turn. So they're a little lower when it comes to like your threat assessment, right? So anyhow, that's the end of the zombie phase. We would remove the noise tokens. You'll find that I'm not particularly good about putting noise tokens down. I do apologize for that. It's just a bad habit I've been in over the years that I've played. And I'll probably continue to forget. So I know to the ode of some of you, it will drive you nuts. But it's, you know, it's me. You gotta love it. But something that I haven't talked to you about is the order of priority. Now, this order of priority only takes place when you're doing ranged weaponry. When you're doing melee attacks, you can select your targets. And when you're doing ranged attacks, they have to go in a specific set of order. And the idea here, and this is an important concept to grasp, the idea here is that when you're performing a ranged attack, you're really just attacking the square or the zone, right? And then you're not necessarily picking out your targets. And so from there, we use a priority tree when it comes to who gets hit first when range fire enters a zone. So the first target in that priority list that's always going to take wounds before anything else is going to be survivors, right? So if you have survivors in there, well, actually, let me double check that now that that's what it used to be. I'm sorry for the confusion. It will be survivors if there's friendly fire, right? You have to reroll your misses, so it's not entirely inaccurate. But as far as once that's taken care of, if there's no friendly fire, then you have a specific order of priority. In other words, you have to remove all of this zombie type before you go on to the next zombie type. So the first in that order is the walkers. These guys, the ones that only take one wound, right? And yeah, just like the two we got behind them. So if we were to shoot this zone with ranged fire, well, there's only two walkers in there, so there wouldn't be anything going on. But if we had a fatty in there, we'd have to take the walkers out first. The order of priority is walker, fatty. In addition to a fatty, you also have abominations, which is you haven't encountered yet. That's the game boss.
And he basically looks like this, this mean baddie. This one, it was actually omitted from this mission just to keep things simple.
That particular zombie, there's only one in the retail box. That's like the level boss, like I said. And he actually takes a special weapon to kill, which is the dragon bile that's set on fire. So anyhow, he's also in the same line of priority as Fatty. So it goes Walker, Fatty slash Abomination, then it goes Runner, and then last but not least is the Necromancer. That's the one that I briefly mentioned about creating additional spawn points, and his figure looks like this. This has also been omitted from this tutorial, really just to keep things simple. And because the Necromancer will pop his ugly head up and just kind of wreck havoc. So yeah, the Necromancer takes a strength of one weapon to kill. That's not difficult, but the fact is that if he escapes from the board, that can be part of your lose condition. That's where I referred to this in the beginning of the first episode. Anyhow, so as far as we're concerned, for the most part, the common enemy, you have walkers, then fatty, then runner. Okay, so it's pretty long-winded, but it's important that you understand that. So, like I said, it's your turn. You don't have any weapons to take down the fatty. So, I think what we're going to have to do here is you're going to have to maybe, you really can't take a weapon from Anne. Remember, Anne, the thing is that when you transfer inventory, you have to be in the same zone as the other survivor. So both Baldrick and Silas, they can only transfer gear with each other. In order to do it with somebody else, they'd have to move into that zone. And remember I told you when you're leaving, in this case, it would cost three whole actions just to move back one square. So there is the option to duck and run, right? But it would basically take each survivor's entire turn to be able to do that. So I don't think that we're going to do that. I think what we're going to do is just try to take out this one runner, right? So let's do that. The first thing that Silas is going to do, we'll go back over here and take a look at Silas. his short bow is the most accurate weapon he has. It hits on a 3+. However, misses can target his ally that's in his zone. So we don't want to do that. We're going to go ahead and roll 5 dice with his greatsword.
And hope that we get that. So that one doesn't count. Drop that one on the floor. And boom, there we go. We got more than enough. And this is a good example. remember, the greatsword hits on 5+. And so basically, he's got two kills. Excuse me. So he has two kills. And basically, it's wasted. You know, one of the dice, which is
a 5, will go to the walker. The other 5 goes to the fatty. But it doesn't damage the fatty because it's not a strength 2 weapon. Okay, you see how that works? So even if I'd rolled all hits, the fatty would have just laughed them completely off. So, yeah, so we'll go ahead and take that walker off. And Silas, at this point, what he's going to go ahead and then do, since he's got 2 remaining actions, he's gonna target this zone over here with the walkers. Now, he can do that because the door is open, so that means he can see into the zone. And he can basically attack that zone. So, and the first order of priority is walkers, and that's all that's in there. So he's going to go ahead with a second action, and he's going to roll 1d6, looking for a 3, and that's what he got. So he takes out one of the walkers, and then with his last action, he's going to fire again, and this time he gets a 5. So he did real well. He picked up 3 experience points.
And three walkers. So we'll go ahead and move him up 3 to 4 total points. And his turn will be done. So now Baldrick, we go back to the main board. He's still in there with the fatty, and like I said. Now, you would think to yourself, well, why don't you go ahead and
search and try to find a better weapon? But remember, the special rule to searching is that you can't search if there's a zombie in your zone. So although that would be nice, we can't do that according to the rules. So what Baldrick is going to do is he's going to go ahead and move out of the zone. And that'll cost him 2 actions, 1 to move and 1 to slip away from that one zombie that was in his previous zone. And he's got 1 remaining action. So what he'll do is he'll go ahead and do that search that we wanted to do so bad, right? And he draws a longbow. So in this case, this is also a strength 1 weapon, so it doesn't really help us in terms of fatties. He's going to go ahead and place that off into his inventory slot. And yeah, so your turn effectively is done. Baldrick still has 1 magic action to perform, but the magic actions that he have would be, they just are ineffective to the fatty. So, so now it's my turn. And what I will do, I'm going to go ahead and charge Ann in. Now, one thing I didn't mention before is
Let's see if we can get a good zoom in here on Anne. Anne has, in her blue skill, it's called Melee Bloodlust. Okay? And what that does is it allows her, it's a special move that's in the game, and it allows her to move and perform an attack all in one action. So, that's quite handy.
That, and we're going to utilize it in this turn. Now, that specific move is good for up to 2 squares away. In this case, we only need to go 1. So she's going to go ahead and perform that that Bloodlust melee. She's going to charge forward and then perform an attack. She has the hammer, which rolls 1d6, right? So now we'll roll, and she gets a 5. So she goes ahead and dispatches that fatty, no problem. And it only cost her 1 action. Yeah. So we'll go ahead and give her that fatty, give her 1 experience, and now she's at 2. And yeah. And she still has she still has 2 more actions remaining, right? So what else could she do? If she really wanted, she could bloodlust the and there's no limitation on how many bloodlusts to do. Actually, I used the wrong figure for that. I said Anne, and I moved Nelly. So I need to retract the experience point from Nelly, and then add it to Anne, which brings her to 4. So, yeah. So she has 2 actions remaining, and she's going to go ahead. I think she's going to leave that runner alone. And we'll deal with that on the following turn as it's going to enter our zone. I'll show you how that works. So Anne will go ahead and she will move into the room and join Baldrick, and then she will perform a search action herself with her last action, and she finds a mana blast, which she'll go ahead and she'll ready that in her inventory, but it's not going to do her a whole lot of good right now anyhow. But who knows? I say that a lot. It's not, you know, because a lot of that is situational, right? You just feel like in that moment it's not going to do you any good. But obviously, if she had nothing there and now she's got some equipment, it's something, right?
Next will be Nelly, who I prematurely moved earlier. And she does have a free... She has that free move action. So
we're going to go ahead and perform that free move action. That'll put her right into the zone with the walker. And that's going to go ahead and allow her the ability to attack the runner with her melee weapon, right? So she rolls a 1d6 looking for 4 or higher, and she rolls a 2, which doesn't do it. So her first action is a miss. Her second action is a hit. She takes out the runner. And we'll go ahead and give her the runner, give her a point of XP, and then, yeah, remove it off of her card. That's really for accounting purposes. And she's got one more remaining action. And with that, she'll go ahead and retract backward because she doesn't want to be here standing in the spawn zone when things spawn. So that's generally a really bad idea. Right now in the blue phase, it won't matter because they're, what you haven't seen yet are their cards that give zombies extra activations. So if they spawn with one card and then the next card is an extra activation, well, then they'd be attacking you if you were in their zone. So generally not a good idea. If you want to be safe, you generally want to stay about a zone away from the enemy if you can help it. Unless you know you got friends coming in to back you up or whatnot, or you have armor or whatever. So that would be Nelly's turn. She's done. And if you're keeping track, and I hope you're learning, so you would know that it's now time for the zombie phase. So we'll go ahead and perform. We'll go ahead and perform the zombie phase. And remember, the first step is attacking. There's no valid attacks. The second step is movement. In this particular zombie, I mean, although he could move over here to this other room, that would be away from the source of the largest noise. So he just keeps banging his head against this wall as if, you know, not smart enough to realize that it's not going to do any good. He can't get through the door. I mean, heck, it took us about 12 swipes to get through that one magical door, so. Yeah, that was classic. That happens to me all the time. I don't know what it is, but anyhow, so that's the second step is movement. And the third step is spawning. And remember, we only have one active spawn, which is over here on the west side. We'll go ahead and pull, oops, that's the wrong card. We'll pull that up. And hey, I was just talking about this card. This is the extra activation card. And basically what it says is that all standard walkers on the board get a free activation. Well, the thing is, we're still in the blue threat level. So in the blue row, it says no one. So there, nothing spawns at this spawn. So all of the extra activation cards are like that, which basically boils down the simple fact that in the blue phase, you have no extra activations. And then every other phase, they will perform their extra activation as indicated on the card. So we're done with spawning. So pretty simple, really. We've carved through these guys pretty quickly. And you'll see, the reason for this is we really only have this one spawn point. The other one hasn't been activated yet. And when that happens, we might get we'll get a little bit more pressure on us, but by then they're gonna be so far away, it's gonna be negligent. We'll probably already be out the exit door by then. So this particular mission is, remember, it's an introductory scenario to get you familiar with the core rules. It's really not designed to be, very challenging. It's really designed, like I said, to get you familiar with the core rules. So anyhow, guys, thanks so much for playing and for staying with me this long. If you're still with us, I hope you enjoyed this. There's plenty more to come from. We will continue out this mission, I think, in the next episode. And then following that, we'll start a whole new mission, a much larger board, more survivors, and you can get, your training wheels, so to speak, off and see a full game in progress. So lots of good stuff happening. If you haven't subscribed already, please be sure to do so. If you'd like to leave a comment, whether it's good or bad or however you felt about the game, please do. I love interacting with the community that's viewing the videos. I think it's really critical. So I just, if I don't hear anything from a comments perspective, then I don't know if I'm doing anything right or wrong or whatever. So anyhow, if you could leave a comment, I really do enjoy going through those and interacting with you guys. And last but not least, make sure you like the video. That always helps us out. So stay tuned for the next episode. We'll see you then. This is Scott from Kill-A-Minis Wargaming. Peace out.